Good afternoon. Welcome to the Hawk Zone. Alongside Coach
Brian Moore.
Brian Moore, or AKA
Brian Keith Moore Jr. This is Southside's most eligible bachelor,
Jordan
Taylor. Of course.
Coming off the normal question to ask here is that, how are we going to bounce back last game of the year?
No, you ask the
same question every week.
That's not the question I was actually going to ask.
Go ahead. What is the question?
I just wanted to ask, you know, as practice has gone on this week, and these seniors know that this is their last week, last game, how have things been for the seniors?
For the seniors?
How are you working in the seniors to get a little bit, maybe a little bit more playing time for people, or have a little bit more fun being this their last time taking the field?
Well, being the last game of the year, you know, that you don't have anything to lose. So we have several unique formations, unique sets, some unique people touching the ball in situations that they usually wouldn't. So that's been pretty exciting to see them get after it and do some unusual things. And we're going to try to incorporate a few other things that the players don't know about yet, just to keep some excitement for the last game.
Thank you very much. We'll be back after this short commercial break to highlight the back here, we got the Powder Puff game of the night. I think we got better coaches on the Powder Puff team. That's just my opinion.
Yeah, it's a tendency where everybody has an opinion, whether they're wrong or they're wrong.
Or they're right.
Tonight we're going to Liberty. Our team's going to Liberty tonight. 6 o'clock, $2 admission to support cancer research. If everybody would come out, that'd be great.
Are you also selling jerseys here at school?
I have a few jerseys left, $30 donation. This jersey that he's wearing right now is actually up for sale. After he wears it tomorrow, anybody that were to purchase it, they would be able to take that jersey to the house.
And I'll fight him for it. Thanks, Coach. We're going to highlight this past Friday's night's game against Milan. Stay tuned. You're in the Hawk Zone.
College life is all about discovery. Discovering new opportunities, new ways of thinking and learning. Discovering the latest in technology and innovation. A campus lifestyle that will mold you and help you develop into a well-rounded, successful individual. Start your next chapter in life here at UT Martin Jackson Center. Day and evening classes available, 6 bachelor degrees, North Jackson, 45 bypass, UT Martin Jackson Center.
Oh.
Welcome back to the Hawk Zone. This past Friday night, the Hawks played Milan on senior night. Coach, how are you? How do you feel about the game?
Well, you know, you're going into a game with an opponent that's more athletic than you at nearly every position and has a lot better tradition than we have, statistically speaking, in the past 30-some-odd years. You know it's going to be an uphill battle all the way, and you just hope that they make enough mistakes to where we can actually stay close for the first half. But obviously, it didn't. And, of course, the rain didn't affect us as much as I thought it would. But it just didn't turn out the way we wanted to.
Your team knows that after the loss, they have no chance at the playoffs. Mm-hmm. So what is the motivation for this team?
Well, I mean, the practice, each player on the team, on average, has put in 240 hours worth of practice time from January 1st until that August the 20th, which was the Thursday before the Obion game. And they put in all that amount of time, and the whole season, if you put the whole season in the time that the ball is snapped, it's only 80 minutes to 100 minutes. You practice 240 hours, and the whole season's only 80 minutes to 100 minutes. So the fact that they're getting to play one more game is enough motivation in itself, because they know that it's the last opportunity a lot of them are going to get to play, whether they're actually 10th grade, 11th grade, or obviously the 12th grade, and not many of them are going to be able to have an opportunity to play next year. And so they're going to take, that's self-motivation right there, because they put all that time into it, and they just got to reap a few more benefits of having the joy to play the game.
Let's get straight to the action from senior night. Well, let's play Westview. Actually, that's
my yes. First thing jumps out to you, I don't know if it jumps out to everybody, but all them lines look nice, looking black. It'd be nice if we do that every game. Ricky just, we're trying to highlight his talents of being able to roll out, and they set the edge pretty quick on that, and we were backed up in our own end zone really fast. Decent seam here. We've got 6 down linemen. They had 4, so you'd think we'd be able to get some yardage there, but I was just a senior there playing fullback, didn't see that guy come scraping across, so I had to come up and punt. Obviously, our punt team's a little lacking in some protection the past couple of weeks. That's our second block of the year. And obviously that didn't turn out like we wanted to. But this time, it was a safety. Last time we had a safety against South Gibson, the officials messed up the call and we ended up losing the game on that play. But here they actually got the call right.
But two is better than six in that situation.
Oh, by far. With two, you still got a little bit of hope. You don't actually give them all the momentum.
Milan down the field and goes up 9-0 right off the bat.
The pattern you see in nearly all of Milan's clips from that Friday night is we have someone there in the backfield or at the for a 0 to 1 yard gain nearly every snap. We just couldn't convert and make the tackle each time.
Tough running there by your running back.
It was. Running a little bit too east and west than north and south.
Tough night for the line up front, blocking-wise.
It was. They had a really good offensive line. They had a lot of depth. Of course, Mullins always had that.
There you got a handoff to Cordier. They called an incomplete pass.
They did. And we run it that way so that they have to call it an incomplete pass if we do fumble. Ricky doing a good job here, getting downfield. Almost picking up the first down.
It definitely helped with his speed on the edges, scrambling around.
It does. You know, everybody's been worried about our passing game. So if they don't have anybody to account for a quarterback, you know, that's going to happen.
Milan back down the field again.
Yeah, and we're just playing man defense like we normally do, because we're usually undersized defensively and offensively. So we got to put an extra guy in the box. So we go man on the edges. So if we give too much of a cushion, it's easy for people to pass on us.
Fullback trap there, I believe. No.
Cyrus picked up that ball, got a decent amount there on that turnover. If we could get a couple more turnovers, I think we would have stayed in the game a little longer than we were.
Yeah, I thought that ball was coming to me. I thought I was about to have some glory. Even though I tripped, it wouldn't have mattered. But now we got the ball back, and Ricky's taking the snap, rolling out. Slings it over to CJ. Great catch there.
It was. Glad they gave it to us. He was out of bounds. He stepped out of bounds twice on that play. They didn't call it, so that's a good thing. The same official that gave us the touchdown at Obine to win the game right there on that sideline. So I was thankful he helped us out once again.
You want him again this week?
That'd be nice. I got my youth pastor from high school this week, though.
Mark Ballard has a pretty good game again.
Mark has had a coming out. The past 2 weeks, he's had twice as many yards as he's had the entire other seven games. In game 8 and 9, he has twice as many yards as he's had the whole year. I think just the feeling of him not being able to play again has really got to him, so it's helped him out a lot.
The play we missed there was a missed blocking assignment there. And
nice pickup on that one,
this
though.
This time it was pretty good.
Yeah.
Cordier Caney for a touchdown.
Yeah, everybody we played had a tough time with Cordier. The only thing that stops Cordier is Cordier. If his legs, something messes up and he tweaks that hamstring, then he's done, but we hadn't found anybody that could cover him yet.
In the first quarter, as you see, it was 9-6 after a missed two-point play. Milan's got the ball again. Pass play here, rolling out, barely missed a sack there. Kind of beat himself up for that. But a great job by Ty Bain breaking up the pass.
It was a good breakup. Ty was playing safety. He's traditionally been an outside backer and moved over from corner last year, so he's done a good job of transitioning some of those week-to-week transitions this year.
Well, Milan does get down the field, and the running back was pretty good.
He was, and I don't really think number 8 was even the most athletic kid out on their team. I would have thought they'd have a different kid back there at tailback.
A rollout here for a touchdown, missed Simon in the...
Yeah, outside linebacker, got to keep contained. That happened quite a bit. We got the same type of alignment this week on that side of the football, so hopefully we'll be able to contain them this week.
Back on offense here with a pass to Data, a guy that hadn't called a lot of balls this year.
Was. Seemed like there for a couple weeks. Cade wasn't too crazy about throwing to Data, but Ricky was fine with throwing to him. Here's a first fake punt, and
you got the first down.
First fake punt right there in 9 years. Got the first down. Worked pretty good, I guess. I'm glad he didn't pitch it because Ricky must have been a little tired. He was behind the plate just a little bit.
Milan, we ended up giving the ball back. And another run by Milan up the middle.
Yeah, and again, right there, we had him in the backfield for a -1 yard loss, and we missed the tackle, and he goes up an extra 3.
they seemed to be able to run the ball up the middle all night long.
They did. They did. With us playing a man and rolling our free safety over to the twins side, there was a small seam there once they get past our initial defense.
Play action opens up another good chunk of yards on the pass play.
It does, and again, we just got to get a little tighter cushion defensively.
Is this outside linebacker again on the edge on this play?
It's hard to tell. It might have been. I have to see it one more time to tell, but Cordell did a good job getting off his block trying to set the edge, but it just didn't work.
Here's a pass that's pretty impressive by a guy that hadn't played quarterback at all this year.
It was a nice pass. I think you'll show it to me, I'm sure, but it was a 221 yard something he had, which is a lot for a guy that you give him 4 days, say, hey, you're going to be starting quarterback. Good luck.
Here's Ricky in the pocket again.
Yep.
Getting away from pressure.
He did a good job there. If he could just get a little bit, just half a second more, he would have had a chance to throw the ball deep.
So at the half, you're down 22-6. This Milan team is a pretty good team.
They are.
Looks like a team that you played a few weeks ago, a 30-27 score, that being South Gibson. What's your prediction on this Milan South Gibson rivalry coming up this Friday?
No comparison. Milan will win by at least 14. No comparison whatsoever. South Gibson has is number 4. Okay. Once number 4 gets frustrated, it's over and they're done. They're too simple offensively. Their defense is solid, but Milan's a lot more consistent offensively than a normal team that South Gibson's played. So they won't go through them like water or anything, but it'll be at least 14-point spread, I think.
That'll be all for the first half of highlights. We'll be right back after this short commercial break, highlights from the second half.
My name is Justice Spouse. I'm a freshman here at Jackson State, and my major is mass communications. The community college really focuses on academics, and that's what I needed. We have the Academic Assistance Center, we have the library, we have the Student Union Building. All of the teachers are helpful. It seems like here at this community college, everybody really cares about getting you to where you need to go.
Jackson State, stay close, go far.
Welcome back to the Hawk Zone. Coach, at the half, you're down a few more points than you have been. All season long, is that the biggest deficit you've had at the half?
Oh, yes, by far.
I believe so. Mm-hmm. It was like 23-6 or 22-6?
I believe so.
Like that.
And again, a lot of that's just a momentum shift when you get a block punt, so it's hard to recover.
Did you see your team being down on their shelves in the first half? And
I was anticipating being down, as I have in a lot of games this year. But I thought we'd still have a decent shot if we were 10 points or less down. Any more than that, I thought we wouldn't have enough. Just from the previous week with Westview even being up, we kind of deflated in the second half because we were gassed, and I thought if we were within 10, we'd have a shot, and obviously we did not.
Let's get straight to the second half highlights from the Milan game. We tried the onside kick, did we not?
Didn't work.
So Milan gets the ball. And,
they ran trips. We lined wrong. We sent the corner over, so there was no edge player on the other side. And obviously they exposed that.
I blame this one on me because I kind of got inside of the fullback coming to kick me. The quarterback got outside for a 70-yard touchdown.
You wouldn't have had much help even if you did contain that. He would have just took it off tackle, I think. And that was a 54-yard run.
I just said something. It just felt like it was forever when I was watching him run to the end zone. But, I believe that play was good enough to be the only highlight of the second half.
Well,
we just didn't want to show you anything else. We didn't.
It didn't get much better after that. You had Ricky's 62-yard run off a waggle.
Mine
might be line. It might be 58, but that was our biggest play of the ball game. And that's why he was a big play of the week.
How do you feel that Ricky performed, man?
Oh, very well. Very well. Now, obviously, we still won't. I'd love for him to be a receiver and kind of a slot back next year if Braden can come along and be a quarterback. But, time span where you really only have two practices on a Tuesday and a Wednesday, I thought he did a heck of a job preparing for that because he gets minimal reps each week as a quarterback. So he stepped in and did a good job.
We're going to now talk about some key players from Friday night's game against Milan. You can take it over here if you want to.
Well, Tariq did a heck of a job. 3.25 is a good average there. We really want 3.5 for a snap, and that's great as a whole offense, not just as a single player. So he definitely did his fair share there. Again, Mark had to break it, or for him, the breakout game, because he's had tough luck this year, and hopefully he'll have a good job this year or this next week. Ricky's done a heck of a job, and we just talked about that. That one pick before half, I just didn't want to quit, so that's why I called timeout and said chunk it deep. So really that wasn't his fault on that one interception. I just didn't want to make it seem like we were tucking it in. I know a lot of teams the past couple of years with Driggers here, we'd just take it in to halftime, and I really didn't want to do that. And you can't take the timeouts of the second half, so you might as well use them. They don't carry over, so we might leave them out there to take them. And Corrier did his normal. Hopefully he'll do the same thing tomorrow. I'll screw it all to pieces, but we got several goals numbers-wise, and he's really close to a particular goal, as well as Ricky and CJ, and hopefully they can get there. Tariq, too.
A name that's not out there, a guy that sat out last week with a concussion, you know. The guy we talk about every week, Kay Willingham, is close to breaking how many yards passing this season?
2,000. You double his jersey number, that 16 becomes 32. He's 32 yards away from 2,000 yards. So if he can get that, that'd be great. Never happened before at Southside because he had the school record a month ago, at least. He stole that from Miss Freeman, the guidance counselor's husband. Wesley had that record up until about 6 weeks ago.
Let's now go to the players of the week.
Ricky's big run on I don't remember the down distance, but that 50-something yard run was a big play. He did a great job there. Practice player was Hunter Ross. He's done a good job all year. Special teams was CJ with the fake punts. We actually faked another punt, but Tariq dropped it. Defensively, Cyrus did a heck of a job stepping in for Ricky. We try to get Ricky on offense so that he can focus on that and not have to go both ways. So you got that explosive player on the offensive side of the ball, and Cyrus did a good job there. And of course, Cordier with his receptions. I want to say he's like a couple of receptions away from 40, but I'm probably lying. But that was definitely our players of the week there.
Coach, you got a tough task this tomorrow night going over to play Liberty team. It's 9-0, one of the best teams around here for sure, ranking wise. What do you have to do to compete with this talented Liberty team?
Basically, you just got to keep it close. They're definitely more talented than we are. I don't put all these smoke and mirrors up and say that we're going to kill them. They're a better team than us. We just got to hope that we can keep it close for the first half. Defensively, their linemen aren't as good as they've been in years past. Skill guys defensively, they're pretty good. They got some height. They cannot defend the pass very well, so we're going to try to expose that. And with Cade coming back, it's a perfect time for that to happen. Offensive line's probably one of the weaker offensive lines they've had since I've been at Southside. Backfield is above average since I've been here. That's pretty much what they've been doing. They've let athletes in the backfield take over the game, and they won't block a soul up their offensive line. The backs will just get loose and take off. So if it wasn't for their skill guys, they would be really average. And I think their only test they had was against Dyersburg, pretty close game. Again, toward the end, the athletes in their backfield just took over the game. They throw the ball decent, but they're primarily run-oriented.
The guy in the backfield, the quarterback, is Corey Newble, a guy that a lot of people around here know. What's so great about the kid?
He's just got that wiggle that you wish that you see on Saturdays. Nominated for the good Lord. The Titans, Mr. Football Award yesterday. I nominated him as the back for our class. He just does what every athlete should do. Never gives up on every play. Just gets after it. I nominated him. I nominated Andrew Goldsmith from TCA for Mr. Football. I nominated the offensive lineman, Trey Smith from USJ for Mr. Football. And I nominated the kicker, I think his last name is Campbell from USJ. There's a couple more that I nominated, but I just can't remember it off the top of my head. Dresser, maybe? I might be lying. Dresser Wynn, yes. I nominated him, and there's a couple more I might have nominated, but I can't remember them we just sat around the coach's table and just made the nominations just last night about 4:30. So hopefully West Tennessee will come home with a few awards in a few weeks.
I'm not trying to ask you a million questions, but
I'm open book. You know, ask them.
With Kay coming back, do you think your chances are higher for sure?
Oh, yes, by far, because you got to think about it. If Ricky's in the backfield, that pulls a receiver out from the perimeter that's making a lot of catches. We put him back on the perimeter, it makes us even more potent there. Otherwise, we get kind of one-sided, and we'll end up running what we call 21 personnel, where you got two backs in the backfield and a tight end, and we don't throw to the tight end a whole lot, so that minimizes our threats out wide. And obviously, them being more athletic than us, we want to spread them out, so we kind of put their defense on some islands. Now we can pick him apart, which is what Cade is good at.
Did he look back normal this week in practice?
He was hit and miss, actually.
He missed a few play calls.
He had some of what I refer to as verbal dyslexia. He'll call one play and run another, which he's done before. So, and he was pretty good his sophomore year, and he did that a lot in sophomore year. So I hope he shows out.
Well, after this short commercial break, we will talk with a couple seniors about how they feel about playing their last high school football game tomorrow night.
I'm Ms. Johnson, and I let my students watch Hawk TV every Friday. And I'm cranky, Ms. Johnson. I don't want my students to watch Hawk TV, so I don't let them. Only Hawk TV has all the current information you need, like events, schedule changes, and much more. None of my students knew that the principal allowed us to wear jeans during the pep rally, because I am cranky Miss Johnson, and I do not allow my students to watch Hawk TV. All my students are laughing and happy when they're watching Hawk TV, and the school spirit around Southside really increases. Because I don't watch Hawk TV, I have plenty of time to give my students extra work and make them miserable like me. Don't be like cranky Miss Johnson. Let your students watch Hawk TV every Friday.
Welcome back. I'm here with senior
Jay Thorpe.
What position you play, Jay?
Running back and inside linebacker.
Okay. Jay, tomorrow night, going to Liberty. It's your last high school football game. How you going to do? How you plan on performing?
I plan on giving it my all, like always. I mean, it's going out there to work, I guess.
How does it feel? How does it make you feel knowing that you got 48 minutes of high school football left?
It's emotional. I mean, like, I'm just, it's just crazy. I don't know. I mean, just ready to play. It irks me.
Well, Jay, as far as the season goes, have you been pleased with how the Hawks have performed since your previous years here at Southside, the last 3 years before this one?
Yes, this year I am. Happy the way we perform, because it's like we just got a lot of fight in us. Like, we ain't scared of nobody.
It's the best record since you've been here, right?
Yeah.
What overall is your best memory playing football here at Southside?
My best memory here is Mark getting smacked at JC on.
Well, thanks, Jay, and good luck to us. It's kind of weird talking in third person, but good luck to the Hawks tomorrow night. It's Travel to Liberty.
Go Hawks.
Go Hawks.
If you don't do your work in high school, you won't graduate. If you don't graduate, you won't get a nice job. If you don't get a nice job, you can't pay your bills. If you can't pay your bills, you'll end up like this guy. Don't end up like this guy who's 40 and still lives with his mother. Do your work in high school.
Hawk Zone, Coach, your team has been pretty good on the road this season. Can they pull off another tough road win?
Well, I think we'll definitely have the stages set for that. You got one, they're 9-0, we're 5-4. They know that they've had our number since 2007, so they're already going to be looking forward to us. You know, they already know that they're the number one seed no matter what. They know that they're going to be playing at home next week, and that's already set in stone. That's locked, because there's no weird situation where they do something weird and they're not the home first seed. And they know the team they're going to be playing is matched up with a weaker district. So obviously that team's going to be a weaker team. So the stage is set for that. We just got to make sure they kind of help us out there and have a couple extra turnovers. I think we'll need to be plus two in the turnover margin to have a shot at it. But I do, I mean, that's why they play the game. Otherwise, we would just take up equipment Monday and just call it a year if we didn't think we had a shot.
Well, some big games going on around here. And I know you're a big high school football fan outside of coaching the Jackson Southside Hawks. So I was going to ask for a few predictions from some big games around here that do involve some playoff spots. And maybe a game that you'll be attending next week if you do go to a playoff game around here. But you got Northside, Chester County. And what's your prediction in that?
I think Northside, I'm not going to say it's a big spread, but they'll win. I mean, I think you'll know. They'll control the game, the whole game. Tabval does a great job. They're going to be more athletic than Chester County for sure. And Tab does a heck of a job with minimal help up there. And I think they'll have that one for sure.
Jackson Christian and a team that's died down this year a little bit, the TCA Lions.
nice little rivalry game there. The Alphabet School is going at it. I'd have to go with Butler on that one, TCA. He does a great job over there. On tape, I've seen JCS a couple times. I've seen Trinity twice. I think they've got a lot more speed than JCS. Not that JCS is a bad team. They made the upset against Westview. McKenzie. But I do think that TCA will pull that one out. He's got them rolling after a slow start.
I know you don't miss being in this district with a Crockett County team and a Lexington team that are both pretty good this season. What do you got on that?
They are. I don't know much about either one of them this year. I would presume that Lexington's got the upper hand right now, just from what scores I've seen. But that might be a surprise there. That'd be the one I'd have to plead the Fifth Amendment and not speak on. I don't know.
About Haywood and Ripley?
Haywood and Ripley. Well, that's an afterthought. Haywood's got that one. Ripley's 0-9, so they're going to have a rough off season, because they're going to end up 0-10. That's the one I didn't talk about. Lyman, Emmett. I did nominate Emmett yesterday for Mr. Football and Haywood.
McNary, two teams out of the region here. McNary traveling to Westview. What do you think about that game?
I doubt McNary drove up there and practiced on their turf like we did, so I definitely give the nod to Westview. McNary's having a little down year there. They changed their offenses to give the kids something to fight for, and they've done better at it. But Westview's just got too many things in place, and they're too consistent to let one go this late in the year.
I'm going to now bring up something I saw on Midweek Crunch Tuesday, a Craigmont team sitting at 1-8 or 0-9, I can't remember, is in a region with four teams and all top four go to the playoffs. So you're looking at maybe a 1-9 team or a 0-10 team going to the playoffs. How is that fair? I don't understand the system there.
Well, it's either you do the top 32 or you do guaranteed bids on the playoffs. And since they switched back to this one, that's just how it works. You just hope that your district is lined up with a district that's about the same skill level. That way you have a decent shot at it. But when you get down there to Memphis, they got some very unique situations where some teams have a football program, some don't. So you end up getting a lot of teams that have a losing record that get in, which I'd rather see that than a 7-3 team not make it. In the old plan, you had 7-3 teams not make the playoffs, which, you know, shouldn't technically happen a whole lot. But it is what it is. On the Z plan, you might play a team in your own district. Like a couple years ago, last time we played playoffs in 2011, we played Lexington, and we had just played them 3 weeks earlier, which don't make any sense. But it is what it is, and that's the system they go with, and that's the way it's been when I was in high school. So I kind of like this one a little better, just because you don't have a 7-3 or a 8-2 team missing out on the playoffs. Or the other thing that happens, you have two 8-2 teams playing the first round, which don't make any sense either. You need that good team playing the bad team, so they have the easiest route to go as far as they can. And this system here does defeat that majority of the time.
You know, your team won't be in the playoffs, so just to finish in thought, what would it say about these seniors if they go out and they do pull this upset as their last high school game?
Oh, it'd mean a lot to them. It'd mean a lot to our program because, like I said, 2007 was the last time that we defeated them, and it's almost like we got the mindset that we can't play with them. But I think it would mean the world to them because they've had a pretty rough past month. Starting off 5-0, everybody's your best friend. And then you drop a couple losses and everybody wants to turn on you. I mean, they might not say they turned on you, but behind your back, they turned on them. The people around school and around South Jackson, a lot of them have turned on them. So I hope that they can come out and surprise some folks and hopefully disappoint some more people like we did the first half of the year.
Well, Coach, thanks for your time. We'll see you back next week for the final episode of the Hawk Zone of the season. Good luck and go Hawks.
Appreciate you having me.
Bills on my mindset, I can't deny it. Getting higher, higher than my income. Income's breadcrumbs, I've been trying to survive. The glow that the sun gets right around sunset helps me realize that this is just a journey. Drop your worries, you are gonna turn out fine. Oh, you turn out fine. Fine, oh, you turn out fine. But you gotta keep your head up, oh, and you can let your head down, hey. You gotta keep your head up, oh, and you can let your head down, hey. I know it's hard, no, it's hard to remember sometimes. But you gotta keep your head up, oh, and you can let your head down, hey, 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 hey. Got my hands in my pockets, kicking these rocks. It's kinda hard to watch this life go by. I'm buying into skeptics, skeptics mess with the confidence in my eyes. I'm seeing all the angles, thoughts get tangled. I start to compromise my life and my purpose. Is it all worth it? Am I gonna turn out fine? Oh, you turn out fine. Fine, oh, you turn out fine. But you gotta keep your head up, oh, and you can let your head down, hey.